Well, good evening, and welcome to Off Planet Radio Live. I'm Randy Maugans, and wow, have we got a show for you tonight. This is going to be rip your head off and drain your brain of any preconceived notions about the reality that you live in, because we pretty consistently blow the top off of things, and it's not by design, it's just simply the place where we look. How you doing tonight? It is Wednesday night, April 24th, 2013, Off Planet Radio Live at offplanetradio.net, offplanetradio.com, and it's been a pretty interesting period of time as well. The fallout from the Boston incident, the Boston Marathon bombing, has continued to recoil throughout the United States in some pretty interesting ways. Don't get distracted by even what the alternative media is pointing you to. There's a lot of misdirection out there right now in terms of information that's being pipelined. I'll just point out one culprit right now. Alex Jones put out a video pointing to a Family Guy TV show that was basically chopped up and made to look like it was doing some type of predictive programming. I saw the whole video. There's no there there. This does not serve the purpose of truth at all, and a lot of the alternative media simply serves as a means to redirect your attention from the basic facts. The mainstream press will not answer ask the questions. They're not going to get answers either. They're not going to ask the question about why in the hell the Boston Bomb Squad was holding an exercise that day, why there was a deployment of bomb squad dogs and agents on the scene at the marathon. It would seem to indicate there was notice given about this event, and yet they didn't bother to clear the area. So the original story, as always, just even going back to like 9/11, you have to go back and look at the original incidents and ask the right questions, because everything's been prepositioned, and a lot of times the story that you get from the media is being scrambled and put together in ways to confuse you from the original conversation. If they had boots on the ground, they had tons of federal agents there, why wasn't that area cleared? Simple answer, there's an agenda here. Were the two Russian so-called sleeper cell agents real? We're never going to know, because one of them's dead and the other one can't talk. Go back and ask the question again. Can they protect you? Do they want to protect you, or do they want to continue to escalate the agenda to take away your rights, to take away your freedoms, to ban firearms, and to basically turn your city into a military police state? Those are the questions that need to be asked, and they have to be based on the right information. And so you have to go back to the most basic facts, and don't get caught up in the dogleg that the media and the alternative media as well is feeding you. Next week, we will have Oxford-trained philosopher and author researcher Chris Carter here. Science and the Afterlife Experience. Chris has appeared on the show before. He is earnestly contending for the research that demonstrates the existence of afterlife. He's fighting against skeptics out there who, basically using science, have continued to control the thought patterns of people and militate against over 150 years of research into the phenomena of afterlife experience. So that will be next week, May 1st, Chris Carter, Science and the Afterlife. My guest tonight is probably one of the deepest, most interesting people that I've had just a very short time to talk to, but I can tell you again that the information that he's going to present tonight will change your paradigms. He comes from the UK. He describes himself as a psychic, Jason Bourne, and he has had a lifetime of experience, and he continues to contend for finding out exactly what it is that's going on somewhere out there or somewhere inside of here. My guest is Tony Topping. Tony, welcome to Off Planet Radio Live.
Oh, good evening. Thank you for that very nice introduction, Randy. That's very good of you to say all that. Very nice of you to say so. And it is all about looking for what the cause is of all this and why it happened, which is still an ongoing thing with the events that happened to me.
Let's start at the beginning with that a little bit, Tony, because you have some pretty distinct memories going back very early in life. And whenever somebody tells me that, I feel a ring of truth. You know, I had somebody tell me one time, how do people remember events that happened to them as small children, 3, 4, or 5 years old? Most children don't have memories that far back. It seems paranormal experiencers do have very intense childhood memories. What are your earliest memories, your earliest experiences?
Well, I think my earliest experiences were to do with before going to sleep, seeing I was a child of 2 years of age and seeing something walk through a wall, and it was absolutely unbelievable, because I can see it now to this day. My father looking at me and going, "There's nothing wrong with the wall. Don't worry about it. You didn't see anything. I'm only 3," and I can remember him say all this. I can remember him trying to calm me down and put me in a cot. I can remember him doing all that, and I remember it very vividly. I remember just, for some reason, I bit my own lip and started to bleed as well, because I was that frightened with what I saw. These two people just walked through a wall. And it was very interesting, was that. And I remember it, vivid memories of that happening. And obviously, you know, I was recently on a ITV program in the UK called This Morning, and we have a skeptic in the UK called Dr. Chris French, who indicated that that incident was actually due to sleep paralysis, and we should be very aware, very wary of anybody like myself who would come out of these experiences. It's a form of brain epilepsy. But I remember it very well, what happened to me. And it was, you know, it's about 7 years of age as well. I had my first UFO really coming over the house. I've been tracked for a very long time. It's been absolutely unbelievable. Probably from about 1972, I would think, I've been watched carefully and monitored by an unseen hand, knowing what I was and who I was. The last person to know all this is, of course, me. You know, I'm the last person, Randy. So what happens is, it's a game of cards, and I hold the supreme cards. Nobody else is telling me this, and I can't see them, and nobody else is telling me, but they can see what I'm holding in my hands, but nobody's telling me. And it's very underhanded and very devious what goes on. And I think also, nothing, absolutely nothing at all, what you might read in the mainstream internet or from some of these researchers, even Whitley Strieber and such like, bears any resemblance at all to real life and what goes on with UFOs. And indeed, as Wilbert Smith, the Canadian UFO researcher, he was approached by the Canadian, the American government, I think it was, and the Canadian government, who, according to his wife, one of the things they said to him was that there is a mental component to the UFO phenomena. And for me, this is where it's at. There is a mental component to it. It's definitely not a delusion. And as far as I'm concerned, it bears no resemblance to anything that's written about in it. And along the way, I've had trials and tribulations, vicious psychic attacks. It's been hell. I've been to hell and back with it. It's not been easy at all. Unethical is, you know, unethical. Anybody who thinks that you're a transcended master as a light being come here to save the world, it's not happening, mate. It's just real life. It bears no resemblance whatsoever to what really, sorry, what is written, as I say, bears no resemblance to what really goes on. Unbelievable.
You hit on something there about the whole ascended master thing and this cult that's grown up around what we call contact or disclosure, a term that I really have come to despise.
Yes.
And there's all these expectations. First off, first contact. Where in history would you even point to first contact? As far as I'm concerned, it's probably beyond any possible human memory at this point. Going back to your earliest experiences, do you have the sense that in some way you were being, the classic term would be abducted, contacted? What type of experiences did you have that were went along with your initial contact experiences?
Well, at that early age, Randy, I was being awoken from sleep at the age of 7, at the age of 10, at the age of 11, and I couldn't define that they were contact experiences. They were something, but I couldn't define what they were. And as a child, as I would fall asleep, I'd have people, all I could describe them is people just looking down at me. It was very odd in the dark. It was very odd. I've often thought that maybe I don't see normally in the dark compared to other people. It's all a bit
odd. That's an interesting interesting.
Yeah, it's like I see, like when I see in the dark, I see like a television screen of dots in front of me, and it was because, and I remember it quite vividly as a child, people looking down at me, and I used to say, "Oh, mummy, I've got," or you know, "Oh, auntie, I've got heads looking down at me when I sleep, they're looking over me," and she'd go, "Oh, that's because you're psychic," you know. And my father, who I came to despise, it was all tragic what happened there. He was supremely psychic. And he would, I wouldn't actually call myself psychic, I would call myself just somebody who's had extreme paranormal experiences, really. But there again, we'll go into all this about being psychic and the consequences. But my father, he would certainly put me on the bed if I was naughty with a headache. He certainly would, and he'd knock me out cold on the bed with the power of his mind. He'd just put, I mean, I've seen him cure neuralgia, I've seen him bring a cat back from the dead, I've seen him revive somebody of a heart attack with the laying of his hands. But he was a very difficult man, a very difficult man to deal with.
What was his background? Did he have, for instance, military background or anything like that?
Well, it's odd. It's very odd you could say that, because I wanted to see his service record, because he kept telling me that there was things he did that he kept quiet about. But according to him, he was a corporal in the army. He became a baker, but he tells me this story of this bizarre approach made to him by the KGB in Austria, and he was warned off by his commanding officer about it all. All very odd. But basically, I never got to the bottom of it, but that's what he was told. But yes, he was in the military, but he had a mental breakdown and he left. He left the military, but one of the things that happened in our family, there was a family incident whereby my mother was in serious trouble with an employer. And I remember this particular day, this particular night, coming back with my father, and my father just saying, "I hope the place burns down." And I remember him sat in the living room closing his eyes, and the boiler room blew up in the place he was talking about. Huge fire. Luckily, there was nobody in the building when it happened. But I remember him distinctly doing that, closing his eyes, and the whole bloody place, the place in town, where, you know, in the other side of town, just going up. The boiler room exploded, major fire in the premises. It was horrendous. And so, you know, I've seen him do all this, and I, as a young man, entered into the occult. At this point in time, in reference to your question, there's no sign of any contact with any form of aliens or any form of UFOs.
Okay.
No sign of it. It's just this bizarre kind of difficult childhood, difficult teenage years, dabbling in the occult, being woken up to strange laughter. I'll never forget that, you know, when I was 12, the demonic laughter waking me. You never forget that. Never ever do you forget that. And it was absolutely unbelievable what happened there. As a child trying to comprehend this, and as an adult trying to comprehend it, it's caused me much trouble. I'm now in my 40s and I'm suffering quite, you know, I would be a lie to say that I'm not suffering mentally from it all, because I have done. It's been a hell of a roller coaster ride. For example, only last week, I'll give you an example of a typical psychic attack using this kind of technology. Only last week I was attacked around about 2:30 in the morning, actually, when I was asleep. And what happens is, Randy, is that whoever they are will switch your brain as if you're in a past memory, but it's as clear as if you are alive sat here now. And I remember this quite well. And I'm kind of like 8 years of age again, back in my old house. In my old bed. It's as real as if I'm sat here now, but it's artificially generated. And the next minute I know, I just get these horrendous attacks to the throat in the form of, believe it or not, in the form of knives coming at you. So you imagine that. Suddenly it changes to this scene of knives coming at you at your throat, and I woke up with a very painful throat. But whatever it is, an unseen hand once again pulls me away from the situation. And it's very interesting. I don't know whether we can go into that now or later, but that's probably to do with the mental component of UFOs and the equivalent of some type of, the movie Inception.
Let me back up a little bit there.
Yeah.
Because you just hinted at something that I find interesting. And I'm working off of a composite of a lot of people that I've interviewed and talked to, you know, over the last few years. And one of the things that a lot of people report is, yes, there's horrendous experiences, there's horrible consequences, psychically, emotionally, physically, but there's also seems to be a protective aspect to this as well. How would you categorize that?
I would categorize that in the line of Dr. Carla Turner. I don't know whether you're familiar with
her. I'm very familiar with her.
When she came out with this little sentence that said that she concluded, and I conclude it as well, a bit similar to the work of Rupert Sheldrake, that at some level, in a way that we don't comprehend, the human species and biology is changing so that it can challenge this reality that is hidden from us. It seems to be a biological function, not just a dismissive brain epilepsy or anything like that. This appears to be a biological function that it seems to be actually guiding us. And I'd go as far as to say, Randy, I'm very familiar with India and their UFO research, and they have this, I'm utterly convinced they had a think tank in India leaking stuff to their own press, just leaking it out, because it was nothing. The UFO data was nothing compared to what's read about in the Western media. In fact, it's a very poor standard in the West. But some bizarre think tank in India that had looked at all this and UFOs and all that kind of thing concluded that the possibility that we are a Type 5 intelligence. In other words, we are a projection of something else that is of higher form, and we're very rare, hence some of us having this these strange carries on. And so in the environment I talk about, there's a distinct possibility that some of us have been left with a calling card that says Type 5 was here, and everything else that's a bit lower down the pecking order comes a running to take a look, hence all the strange goings on and all the carry on. That it's taken years to reach these conclusions, however bizarre, but it's part of the understanding of it that you, it seems to be. Yeah.
No, you actually have put a classification on something that I've been talking about for quite a long time. Yeah. I'm of the opinion, based on the phenomenon, studying it both in the current era, but even going back historically, that there's something extremely fascinating to other beings about the human race, and specifically about certain strata of the human race.
Yes, this is absolutely correct, and I've reason to believe that in some cases some of us are human beings, but our souls, our biophysical bodies, the realm that projects into this mental component is slightly different from other human beings. Hence us being hit by all this paranormal activity, the UFOs coming over, this, that, and the other. It's all very drip, drip, drip. It's all very, they keep the distance. They don't tell you the full story, these people behind the UFOs, and what's going on. But it makes sense. It certainly makes sense that that's probably what has been going on and is going on at the moment. It seems to make sense from my point of view. And I could be wrong, and I'm open to all suggestions as to what it could be. But this seems to be where it's at the moment. It explains a hell of a lot. It really does.
Now, growing up and having these experiences, and I know you said you didn't really at that time consider yourself psychic per se, were you having psychic experiences? Were you, for instance, having extrasensory perceptive experiences or clairvoyance or anything like that along with these initial experiences, Tony? Now, it looks, did we lose him? Looks like we did. Okay, I'll tell you what, let me pull Tony back in or see if he'll call back in. Let me throw up some music here. I'm not surprised by this. I was expecting this was going to be kind of a difficult show tonight. So hang in there for a few minutes. Let's see if we can get our guest back. Okay, and we're back. We have our guest back up on the line. Tony, welcome back.
So, yeah, we'll come back around it. I think that's typical of what happens, isn't it, really? Just typical of what happens, with it being me you're interviewing, maybe. So I think we were talking about childhood, weren't we, and psychic experiences.
Yes, exactly.
Is that correct?
Thank you.
There was a lot of, you know, a lot of, it wasn't so much psychic experience, but it was intense dreams of nuclear war, and, you know, my childhood dreams were dominated with all that, with nuclear war. I used to wake up crying with these horrendous visions of it, and it was just... It was just really, really odd. I can't really recall any psychic experiences until about 91, 96, probably 97, when it really started kicking in, when I started larking around with it all. And it's, you know, that's when it really happened. All the psychic experiences started going on there, really. But in childhood and in teenage years, I had a very difficult time. You know, it wasn't easy. I do remember casting a love spell on somebody and that backfiring on me, you know. So it really was, I suppose, 91 when my first UFO incident happened, and it came in over the house like something out of Close Encounters for about a split second, and then disappeared. And I was left wondering what was going on. And that was in 91, you know. So, and then I went to drama school in 96. Sorry, 91 I went to drama school, sorry, shortly afterwards, and nothing really happened then either. So you see, there's nothing really happening. Really, apart from the fact that, you know, my father was psychic, I was having strange dreams, and I was having strange goings on as well that I just couldn't understand, and this would later on develop into one hell of a roller coaster ride in the years ahead for me.
Now, you've indicated to me that along with these experiences, you've caught the attention of let us just say very interested government types.
When did
that begin to show up?
It began to show up probably earlier than I would probably know, but it began to show up, I'd give you the precise date, on the 17th of the 5th, 1999, all hell broke loose when I had a UFO come in over the garden and illuminate a television antenna and fly back off again. Whoever the people who are monitoring me knew all this was going to happen before I did, and I was filmed by an unmarked helicopter as well, and that was a very bizarre incident. He broke every air regulation in the book, and it was a green unmarked thing. We had it analysed by Jane's Defence Weekly. It's a special forces military helicopter that is not used by British forces, it's used by US forces.
Mm-hmm,
they're bristling,
mm-hmm.
bristling with camera gear, and it's a winch variant sliding door AS-550, which I understand is a very rare helicopter indeed in that configuration, from what a Lynx helicopter pilot was saying. He'd never seen anything like it. And then the phone calls started coming, you know, telling me to shut up, keep quiet, this, that and the other. And all because this UFO had come in over my house, illuminated a TV antenna and flew off again. We had that analysed. And the guy who analysed that was a special effects director, and he also concluded that it was a UFO. And it was very interesting indeed. Whoever they were, and I think I know who they are, had a specific purpose. They came in on intentionally. They illuminated the antenna intentionally and flew off again, knowing exactly what they were doing. Because these people in the UFOs, they don't do anything by halves. They don't just come in for tea, and there's always a driven reason as to what they are doing. And so I started getting followed as well, which was very bizarre. And I started getting attacked by an advanced form of technology that would be called psychotronic. I'm curious as it's to its delivery system, but definitely I would be awoken at 2-3 in the morning by the most horrendous screaming noises, gunfire in the head, anything, you know, you name it, it happened. It was horrendous, including defecating the bed as well. Feelings of doing that you just couldn't believe it, Randy. You just wouldn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
And well, you probably would, actually, a man like you. You probably would, with all the research you've done. And you know, it was horrendous. And so you've got this bizarre situation where you're sat in a pub with your friends, and it was quite odd because I was continually dreaming about a particular man who was possibly responsible for all this, and I kept dreaming about him, and it was very, very odd. And he looks like an actor that is called Nestor Carbonell, although Mr. Carbonell has absolutely nothing to do with this whatsoever. It's just, if you get, that's what he looked like, this man. And so we're sat in the, I'm with the pub and some friends, and in he wanders, this man, in he wanders with his sidekick, a female sidekick. And this has very worrying ethical implications as to what is going on, because this goon squad turn up in a pub and they always carry vehicle keys with them. Always in a vehicle. He had vehicle keys on him. He had a vehicle key on him. And I remember he ordered a Coke with a smile with his sidekick. And then they leaned back against a wall that had a mirror on it and just observed me. And I knew what was going on and they knew what was going on. My friends around me were completely oblivious. And then I walked past him and he mentioned to his sidekick what I was doing and mentioned what he was doing in the mind control harassment situation that was in, and only he would know that, Randy. Only he would know that remark that he made. He would only know that in reference to what was going on. So a guy in a pub randomly makes a remark that only you would know in reference to going on. You know you're being followed,
right,
and then
right.
his sidekick kind of like stepped back as I came back from the toilet. The sidekick stepped back, he was a female lady, and leaned back into the mirror and said to him, "Why isn't Tony talking to us?" And his reply was, "I don't know." This in the pub, oblivious to, you know, to all this. And then next minute, he realised that I wasn't responding. And then in the next minute, he then just said, "Come on, let's go," and disappeared. What would have happened had I met him? What was he after? Why was he there? Why did he come to the pub? He was after something. He was in driving distance in a vehicle of that pub. He didn't travel far either. This all leads to some very unethical and strange goings on by an agency that is unaccountable to the parliamentary process in our country, and certainly unaccountable to your process, in your country as well.
Well, the issue is too, Tony, and you probably know, as I've gotten information, that the United States has maintained bases, specifically the NSA, through the military in Great Britain since after World War II.
Yes.
I don't know if you know who Barry King is, but I've interviewed Barry King a number of times and talked to Barry extensively. And, of course, he's talked quite a bit about what goes on at the base called Peacemore, which was, in fact, a U.S. military installation where, according to Barry's testimony, not only was there secret projects going on, mind control operations, but also the presence of reptilians on the base.
Yes. Yeah, indeed. And if you look at that with the reptilian issue, there's that famous thing, Randy, it's a famous interview to do with David Icke and Jesse Ventura.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know, when David Icke, he's not everyone's cup of tea. I know this, and I know that I think you've definitely looked at his research. But what is interesting is his reptilian research, and it's quite interesting. And Jesse Ventura asked all the wrong questions, and Mr. Icke gave him all the wrong answers. Because from a espionage point, psychic espionage point of view, some of the guys who were involved in the remote viewing program in the 1970s, including Joseph McMonigal, says in his autobiography that he had a reptile stood in his kitchen, and he it was like something out of Airplane, where the guy goes to the fridge and there's a horse sat at the table, that famous clip in Airplane. It's like something like that, and he walks back out again. And I have to say, from my experiences, that there is a subconscious realm, or a conscious realm, that dates back to, it's hard to take in, but I think it dates back to prehistoric times, where that biology and all that consciousness has continued to this day. That's my actual take on it.
You're speaking of the reptilian here.
Yeah, I'm speaking of how it actually works. So it might not necessarily be a reptilian as in a giant lizard stood in front of you, but it is a form of consciousness. It is a form of reality that is still present to this day. And it's interesting, to say the least. If you met an alien who was in a UFO from another planet and knew his stuff, they'd probably tell you that as well, because, you know, the precision biological engineering of the dinosaurs, at some point some of them must have learnt to walk and talk, and at some point that biology has been swept under the carpet but is still here. and its presence is felt in the symbolism that we see, for example, in the City of London and in other places. Interesting, and I could be wrong. And you might know more than me on it, right? But it seems to be. I'm basing this on the references of my experiences, you know.
There are people that I've talked to and who are close to me that have had very direct experiences, and in some cases, what they've indicated to me is that these are in fact interdimensional creatures as well.
They are. Yes. Yes, and they're not short on humor either. They're quite
one
amusing.
One would hope not.
No. In the course of my experiences, they're quite amusing to reveal what they are, you know, and where they've come from, type of thing. It's unbelievable. It's a black comedy, frankly. Coping with that, him going out the pub and saying I don't know and all, let's go, you know, and all this kind of thing, being followed again. Followed by somebody else who had a foreign accent. That was all very bizarre as well. And I'm known as a Tony, but she said, "See you later, Anthony," you know, in some bizarre foreign voice, which was, she was like Tigger, she was like on heat. I don't know what the bloody hell the feather on, but she was bounding about in this, this bizarre, absolutely bizarre. And you do wonder, Randy, you do, if you think, what am I looking at there, really? You know, what is going on
there?
Yeah,
what the hell is that?
What the hell is that? You know, and it's bizarre. But so, you know, these incidents of mind control, being followed, being awoken at all hours, takes its toll on you, because you've probably breached the reality of the matrix of human society. You've suddenly breached. Something's happened to you, and you're not quite sure what's gone on. And that can relate to time travel as well, and all the other stuff that goes with it. You know, it's absolutely bonkers. But the thing is, though, it does take its toll on you. I am suffering from it. It's certainly taken its toll on me. It's not funny, Randy, being awoken at 3 and 4 in the morning by strange goings on bombarding the epicenter of your mind by a technology that you don't understand. And if it is a brain epilepsy, and if it is something that is kind of like some sort of human disease, then the complexity of what is going on to generate sound effects to precision and precise reality, precise inner reality revolving in your head with technology is that must be a staggering feat of nature, Randy. Do you get the drift?
Oh, absolutely. And the issue with this is that there has been a long campaign to attribute the experiences of people who are reporting this phenomena as some form of mental illness. The problem with that lies in the fact that people who live oceans away from each other, people who have no cultural commonality, people from different walks of life are reporting experiences in much the same way that you are, both publicly and privately. And I can't tell you how many conversations I have with people that are reporting the kind of phenomena that you're talking about, Tony.
Yeah, well, this is absolutely correct, you see. And so you start looking at this thing that's coming at you within the framework of the inner landscape of the mind, and you start getting sensitive to it. It's quite amazing. You start watching it and observing it and trying to find out what it is, and then you realize that it's giving off a signature. It's giving off a feeling. It's giving off an instinct. It's present. It's there. What is it? What are you looking at? Really, kind of thing is the thing, and in some cases what you are looking at is a very, very ancient force that has been around us for a very long time, and you see, this brings us very nicely indeed up to the US intelligence and its discovery in 1950 via Nick Redfern's excellent work, The Collins Elite.
Let's talk about
the intrusion of non-human entity into this mental component of the UFO phenomenon that the American government is fully aware of, and its Department of Defense is aware of. And I was aware of it before reading the research. I twigged on this. And the reason why I twigged on this was due to a book by Linda Howe called High Strangers Volume 1, where she'd been approached, or a colleague of hers, but I think it was Linda, had been approached by two agents from the Department of Defense who was... I can't remember what they were commenting on, but I think they were commenting on something she'd written, and they were more or less saying that they had studied this and concluded that non-human entities were a root cause of these problems that you've just commented on, Randy. And they were also commenting further that they'd studied the physics of wholeness and the implicate order as a real yardstick, that David Bohm's wholeness and the implicate order. Yeah. They seemed to use this as the yardstick as to what was going on. And so during the 1950s, I think I'm going into a bit of Nick Redfern stuff here.
Yeah, no, go ahead and cover that. Yeah. It's important because...
It's important, okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, well obviously during the 1950s, therefore, the American intelligence was absolutely baffled as to why UFOs had suddenly started to come into their airspace. This was actually known as the UFO Air War of 1950.
Yes.
And it's documented quite fully in an excellent book called Shoot Them Down by Frank Fischino. Obviously that some elements within the Air Force and the Army and the CIA wanted to know what the cause of this was, and they reached this conclusion that somebody somewhere had possibly opened a portal, a gateway, to actually let them in via occult means. And so what they did is they studied that, and they formed something called the Collins Elite, which is related to a state in New York that makes cheese. And they consulted vicars, they consulted anybody they could in order to understand what exactly was going on. What fascinates me is they pinned it down to a rocket scientist, as I understand, according to Nick's research, who was causing all this via his rituals. And Collins Elite to this day, further rumor mill is said, will approach the police and so on and so forth, questioning the nature of ritual murder and all this kind of thing, and what was going on, and whether it's related to UFOs or not. And obviously, I'd emailed Nick because I was researching it as well, and he'd come up with this thing called the Collins Elite. And what is fascinating is there's this reference to Loftus Boat. This continuous code word. So in Majestic...
Say that very slowly, the last part of that.
Loftus Boat.
What is the last word? How is it spelled?
Boat is spelled B-O-A-T.
Okay. All right.
And it seems to be a code word within the framework of the Collins Elite, who only had one British member. They only had one British member, the rest was American. But it seems to be a code word, Loftus Boat, as to the reference possibly to the man in charge and what he was thinking at the time when all this was going on. Loftus Boat thinks this, Loftus Boat considers that. And definitely what they were dealing with, it would appear, is they were dealing with some kind of breach within the human biological collective mental framework subconscious. Some kind of breach was coming in that was ill. And you see, Randy, from a military intelligence point of view, I would assume that if you're looking at an invading force coming in but is unknown, you're not going to see them with UFOs and lasers tearing up the street. They're a lot cleverer than that. They're going to come in via the human mind, which has no firewall. They're going to come in via that direction. And I think these were the obvious conclusions that they were certainly reaching. And what is staggering about all this is that they thought, according to the Department of Defense in the ongoing battle with them, that their technology was pretty strange and pretty advanced, what they were dealing with. They couldn't quite work it out. And at one point, they were given the impression that they were winning, when in fact it was done all intentionally. But I think that what they'd stumbled across was a very, very ancient force that had been around us for a very long time. And I think if you look at the excellent work of a researcher that I think you know, maybe a friend of yours, I've spoken to him, Robert Stanley. I think you're familiar. Is it Robert Stanley?
I am familiar with Bob Stanley.
Yeah, Bob Stanley. Yeah. Well, he's really looked at this and the occult, and I think all the stuff that goes on with Washington. And what you've got is you've got a scenario going on where you've obviously got a virus inside the machine of the human collective, and these people who are turning up at these kind of rituals and gatherings and worshipping symbolism, and the symbolism in the pop industry and all that kind of thing relates to an overruling intelligence that has been around mankind for a very long time. And you won't probably read that in any UFO books, but E.T. does refer to them as the ancient ones, as if we are ruled by the ancient ones. And there seems to be this, how the question is not that they exist, and for me the question is, how the hell did they get here? How and why is the question.
Well, some people have called them interdimensionals and insist that, in fact, they've always been here, and, in fact, they are hidden from view. And there's interesting data I've gotten just the last couple of days on some things that are going on around the Marianas Trench. And the fact that there's a whole flotilla of submarines out there, and it seems to be connected to a structure that is either to be submerged or already has been submerged within the trench. Now, nothing human can withstand the Marianas Trench. It's 7 miles deep. The pressure crushes anything human, including our best subs right now. So the question is, you know, is there something inside the Earth? And what is it, and where is it coming from?
And that is the question. Because you see, when you look at it, when you then piece it together, what you've got is the scenario of you've got visiting higher ET intelligences, then you've got the issue of non-human entities, and then you've then got the issue of Germany and Antarctica after World War II.
Yes.
Causing a bit of mayhem as well. And these are the things within the UFO phenomena that are the kind of the things that government get jumpy about, especially Antarctica and what went on there and the non-human entities in terms of UFOs and what they are. And as a result, I don't know whether you would agree with this, Randy, as a result of that, we've now got a shadow government who probably shoots down anything that moves that resembles a UFO, causing no end of, I don't know, further confusion and chaos.
Well, the weird thing about this, Tony, is they seem to know more than they let on.
Yes.
They seem to almost, in some cases, be complicit with some faction, and yet at the same time, they keep the public completely in the dark about this. I interviewed Commander Bob Dean, who's very well known in the UFO circles. About 3 years ago. And Bob Dean told me, flat out, yes, there are extraterrestrials, as he termed them, here. Not only are they here, but he said they are inside the Pentagon. Now, Bob Dean is very credible. He's considered to be one of the earliest disclosers, having come out of, you know, pretty high military rank.
Mm-hmm.
And Dean's telling me, yeah, they're inside the Pentagon.
Yes. Yeah, that's it. His famous quotation, is it, from the NATO document, the assessment, is that you would walk past one down the street and you would never know. You would literally never know. Or you would sit next to one on an airplane and you wouldn't know. And that's very correct as well. That's very correct. I mean, the bizarre incidents in London of the special boat squadron within Britain. I read it on the internet, an account of one of the special boat squadron guys going to arrest something like that, apprehending some of them on the tube, on the London Underground network, some bizarre individuals who they, and obviously that all went hush-hush. But it's just, I don't know whether that's true, but it's just one of the many examples, isn't it, of they look like us. And therefore, when I'm being followed like I was, I had to ask, what am I looking at, really? You know what I'm saying? What am I really looking at here? It's all very interesting, isn't it? How it all pins together. It certainly is, and I think that humanity is caught in the middle of it. From what I understand from my own ET experiences, they tell me that there are a number of governments on this planet that are talking to them a lot, but there are strict protocols involved in communicating with them. That's just an insight that I learned. Whether it's true, I don't know, but there seems to be strict, what those protocols could be, I have no idea, but there seem to be strict protocols. But as you say, yes, there is an element of these ETs that are possibly involved within the government, or within an element of the government that are speaking to each other and developing technology. And the human race is left in the dark. And you get these people that you're going, disclose it, we're not failing to realise that one of the most important equations is the aliens are possibly also part of the prevention of disclosure process as well. And I think that will be very correct based on what we've just spoken about, you know.
Our connection's getting fuzzy for some reason, Tony. I don't know what's going on.
Can you hear me now? Is that all right? Can you hear me?
Yeah, it either is a bad connection, unless you've got a microphone connection that may be faulty.
Right. No, I think we're okay. I think we're all right here. There's nothing in the case.
Okay. What we may want to do is disconnect, and I'll have you call back in because the line got really fuzzy again.
Very good. All okay. Right. So you want to disconnect and call back in, yes?
Yes, please. And we'll go to music here.
Very good. Okay. We'll do.
Well, that's interesting. The connections are not real good. Considering we do shows from Europe and Australia, that's pretty bizarre. Okay. So we'll bring you back up with Tony here in a second. We'll get the phone line cleaned up. Okay, we're back. And, Tony, you're back as well.
Oh, marvelous. I take it you can hear me okay now.
Yeah.
So much to talk about, isn't there? So much to cover. It's just unbelievable the amount of stuff that's out there, isn't it? Just absolutely unbelievable in terms of trying to piece it all together in your own way as well. As an individual person.
This is the great mystery that we're tasked with, I think. Every person who is investigating this honestly, and to be fair, there's a fair amount of disinformation out there. There's a lot of insincere people that are doing this work. But anybody that's looking at this, and you said it earlier, we don't know exactly what all of it is. We're putting clues together as we go. And it's very telling because the experiencers, the people who have undergone this, a lot of times are just searching. They want to know, what is this phenomena? Where did it come from?
Yes.
And more importantly, why are we involved in this?
Yes.
And if you look at your early experience, and it's very similar in some ways it's not, every case is different. You were very young when you began to experience this. And in a way, it feels to me like certain souls came into this life tagged.
Yes. Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And you know, it's interesting because I was attacked twice by two UFOs. There was an incident that happened in a farmer's field where the things looking at me, hovering in the middle of this field, like a dot of light, hovering in the middle of this field, just looking at me, and it looked like a gunfight at the OK Corral. And I thought to myself, you know, that this thing's gonna attack, and it certainly did. It certainly did something, and then flew off. I'll never forget it. It wasn't very pleasant, and then it just flew on its way. And the same thing happened about a year later, coming back from a night shift. And I think that was New Year's Day. I think that was New Year's Day morning, coming back from a night shift from where I was working. Came in over the roof. My whole school started vibrating. I thought it was going to knock me to the ground. And this gauntlet, it's very odd. You've got this, with me, you've got this gauntlet that you're running all the time of this negative force, this element, this hostile element of constantly harrying, constantly. And I concluded, after seeing the UFO that had illuminated the TV antenna, that these dots of light that were harrying me, it was like watching a nature program on the telly, because in some cases this UFO that illuminated the TV aerial, I've actually seen different types of UFO shoo these dots of light away, just shoo them off, and you're thinking, what are you observing there? It's like looking at a reality that is completely, we are completely oblivious to, that's going on in the skies around us. Even your Air Force, the US Air Force, is considered one of the most powerful military apparatus in the world, but I really don't think they've got anything that can match some of the technology that they're using at the moment into these UFO individuals, and I know
over my experiences over the years that the ETs behind the UFOs are very concerned over the nuclear issue, very concerned over what we would do with their technology. It's like having giving toys to children. Their technology works entirely differently to what ours does in many different ways. And it's you know, in a lot of cases, from some of the interviews I've read, even Philip Corso said that it was beyond his comprehension. Just unbelievable, isn't it? Are you familiar with the Cabinet Report?
Say that again, because we're still getting a terrible signal.
Are you getting this terrible signal from me? Can you hear me okay?
Now you're clear again.
Clear, that's very odd. Have you heard of the Carrot Report? I don't know whether you've
I have,
heard
but I haven't read that.
You haven't read it, okay. But basically, in a nutshell, what fascinates me is the concept of, in a computing system, we have hardware. But in their system, a single letter can also be software and hardware. So if you imagine reading a page on a book, their technology, those letters would actually become hardware as well as software and create a function. So you've got letters, and you see it now where you snap a photo of a code on a wall, it gives you a load of stuff, where letters can act as computing functions and hardware. I found absolutely amazing in the Carrot Report. It kind of like gives a glimpse of what goes on. And I think the other thing we were going to come to was the Wingmakers, wasn't it? We were going to have a look at that, because I thought that was very interesting as well, regarding the technology involved in that.
You're talking
cycling,
blank slate technology.
That was right, because what happened to me in all this was the fact of the matter was, and it is a fact that happened to me, was that I was looking at the Wingmakers website. Now I know everything there is to know about it being a hoax. But the thing is there's something in it. There's definitely something going on with it that is deeper than what it's saying. It's just, it really is. And I remember I started, there's an interview on there. I think it's interview one by a guy called...
Dr. Neruda.
Yeah, Neruda, yeah. And he's talking about the Cortinium and 15 and all that kind of thing. And it's just very odd. I'd like to share the incident with all this, with your listeners, if I may, because it's not something I'm going to talk about. But basically what happened was that with this blank slate technology, I read all this about it being like you could get into that each event is a timeline intervention point. That can be influenced. It's a signal in time, and it actually is. If you look at Stanford Research Institute's protocol on remote viewing, when they develop CRV, that's based on the signal from noise kind of thing. I don't know if you're familiar with it, Randy, but it uses the ideogram.
Yes.
Where the conscious is separated from signal from noise. And this was very interesting. In a few paragraphs, it was explaining a very advanced remote viewing technology whereby anything in the future is signaling on a timeline. You'll hear that signal coming back to you. What happens if you have the ability to influence that signal and change its structure, which is what he was talking about? And what is amazing about it, for example, is that therefore you could influence one event, but it would generate another. So you could influence somebody being, what's the word I'm looking for? You could influence somebody being prevented from having a car accident.
Yes.
But because of your influence in that event, another accident occurs where back into a lamppost.
Yeah, this goes into remote influencing and cascading event timelines.
It does indeed. It certainly does. And this appears to be what's happened. So I started larking about with it. I started having a play with it. There was one incident that happened where the town was going to flood with a river. As bizarre and surreal as this may seem, this town that I was in, Selby, there was a chance it was going to flood and the river was going to come over. And I started larking about with all this, with blank slate, in that, you know, if the incident of the river is flooding this town is a signal, a convergence, a manifested biological signal on a timeline, then it can be influenced and erased or swept off a timeline and moved somewhere else. And so that's what I did, and the town didn't flood. And I thought, oh, that's clever. So I just started larking around with it, having no idea what I was obviously doing. And there were consequences. Now, the fascinating part of this story is this. I can't say what I did, but I did something with it that was very irresponsible. I was projecting something. I knew, I just knew what I was doing with it. I don't know why I knew, but I did. And it ended up with something happening that shouldn't have happened. As a result of that, I was at work one evening, and I got an anonymous text message, Randy, an anonymous text message on my mobile phone, telling me precisely what I'd done, and not to do it again, thank you. Which was absolutely just surreal. Surreal. It really was unbelievable. So somebody somewhere knew exactly what I was doing, and they stated what I'd done, and said, please could you not do it again, thank you. Which is just surreal, you know, and that actually happened to me, and it was bizarre. So there's something within this little interview to do with the Wingmakers and BST. There's something in it, and as you say, it is about remote influencing of events. Change one event, however, and this is the thing that I discovered as well. Change one event, and another event happens in a different way.
I don't know how familiar you are with the channeled material that came out in the 70s by Jane Roberts called the Seth material. But in the Seth material, Seth talked about this and about the fact that every decision is like a decision tree. If you know how a decision tree works, it's sort of like logic programming in computer software. Every decision branches off into another decision tree, hence you generate more potentialities, more limitations depending on how you choose things. Seth said that everything that can happen does happen. It happens multidimensionally and across a span of what we call time, but it actually isn't time. It's actually sequence in a continuum. So
yes, it is. Yes, it is. Very important point you've made. Yeah, yes, it is, Randy. Yeah.
So what you're talking about is the bleed over of other, we call them timelines. It's probably the best we can do in understanding what's happening, specifically with remote influencing and where you are exerting influence on external events. But it seems as though whatever occurs, there is psychic pressure. That's a poor term too. It's going to squirt out somewhere else.
Yeah, this is absolutely right. So you know, for all you know, you influence something, let's say, preventing an incident somewhere, and some alien in some backyard planet suddenly gets the incident manifest in front of them, or it happens within their environment in a different way. And this is obviously the thing that these guys were writing about. It's very subtle. I don't know what your opinion is on the Wingmakers, Randy, as to there's something in it.
I've interviewed Mark Kemple, who is kind of the front man for Wingmakers. James, who is the creator of Wingmakers, is for the most part anonymous. He's done one interview with Mark back in 2008. I've interviewed Mark twice, and we've gone pretty deep into the material. Like I said to you privately, the Wingmakers material is categorized as a mythology.
Yep.
The mythology is a composite, and so people read this and they have to understand that it is exactly what James describes as encoded material. It's designed to transmit information, and according to the legend of the Wingmakers, the Wingmakers are basically us in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So it is us communicating to us across what we call a timeline, but again, it's part of a continuum. You know, and this is the part, because here's the thing, Tony. All of us have been trained by our education system, by our culture, to be literal and to be empirical in data. This does not serve us well in the realm of inquiry that we're doing. And that is part of what the Wingmakers attempts to communicate, is that there is an encoded stream of data that comes in forms that the human can absorb, and part of that is in a story which you would think of as fiction. But fiction is actually simply a device to communicate data to bypass the logical process of the brain.
Very true indeed, isn't it? I think that's accurately summed up what the Wingmakers is all about. And I'd be very interested to understand the UFO contact experiences of James, because he really is something else.
Oh, trust me, I've tried. I would love, this was my initial contact with Mark Campbell was... Yes. Can I please interview this guy? What I do understand about the Dr. Neruda material is that it is based on actual events. It has to do with the black operations here in the United States and what happened after the discovery of a trove of artifacts out in the desert.
So is that right? So it's not so much a hoax. It's actually based on actual events, is it?
Well, some of it comes dangerously close to actually revealing certain names, including the original name of Dr. Neruda was Dr. Anderson, and and anybody who's familiar with the work of another Dr. Anderson, who's detailed in some of the books by the Montauk guy. His name just slipped my head. He wrote a book called Transylvania Sunrise.
Right.
And he details the work about this Dr. Anderson, who works in the area of time travel, or time control, as Dr. Anderson calls it. So there are details within this that are encoded that may in fact be very factual, but obviously designed to protect those involved with the projects.
Yeah, well, this is absolutely it, you see. And the thing is, with the time travel issue, is that you're now getting into a realm whereby on this signal line that we're talking about, I know Joe McNonagle did a book called Remote Viewing Time Machine, where he's remote viewing a timeline into the future and it's coming back. And this is precisely with some of us what is going on. And I think, Randy, there's famous. Are you familiar with the story of Alec Newald at all and his abduction experience?
I'm not, no.
You're not, okay. Well, there's a story regarding it. Well, Alec Newell was harassed.
Hey, Tony, your sound's getting fuzzy again. Are you close to your microphone?
No, I'm not, actually. I'm just... Is that any better?
Yeah, try it now.
Is that better for you? I don't know what's...
Yeah, we may have to disconnect again. We actually have an hour break coming up, so maybe what we can do is try one more time on a connection, or we'll work something else out. Why don't you hold that story over? We'll take a break here and play a little bit of music. Let everybody, including me, take a short break, and we'll try and get the sound cleaned up, because I suspect that tonight was going to be a difficult interview, and it has fully lived up to all my expectations. So with that said, we're going to take a break on this side, and when we come back on the other side, we'll pick up the details. There's a lot of things that we're going to talk about in the next hour. We'll go as long as it's fun and it's interesting and we still have energy. We'll be right back after this brief break. This is Off Planet Radio Live, Hour 1 for April 24th, 2013. We'll be right back.
Human biology.
ecology is under stress as never before. Environmental hazards, genetically modified foods, toxins in the earth and air, chemtrails, and escalating radiation levels. How do we get control? Thanks to the work of a team of researchers, we are pleased to announce a revolutionary natural technology that can help your body rebuild its original coating. RNA Drops is a completement formula based on the newly discovered iCell. RNA is the building block of DNA. These new DNA structures are the gateway to what is called ascension. Many users of the RNA Drops have discovered the benefits of a product as unique as their own biology, finding newfound well-being, peace of mind, and a sense of control over their destiny. Like me, they are enjoying a sense of empowerment within their own bodies and emotions. To get all the details on RNA Drops and to find out how you can obtain a free mini bottle, go to rnagenesis.com. That's rnagenesis.com. Hated to take that music down. Well, the people on the archives won't hear it. That was Tool, No Quarter. I know it's heavy metal, but indulge me. You'll get heavy metal, hip hop, new age, just about anything I feel like whipping out of the can on the breaks. Welcome to Off Planet Radio Live. Again, April 24th, gosh, I forgot what date it was. I'm having time slippage here. And very interesting show tonight. We're suffering the ravages of technical deficiency, interference, and thank you to those on the chat room. Thank you to those listening. Thank you for sending us energy. We needed it. There is this whole thing that people are talking about now, and it's coming from all over the place about this energy thing. People go through periods of just almost complete collapse energetically. And I think some of this has to do with what I guess we would call the shift or the collapse of certain paradigms that are going on right now, and our own biology responding to energetics that are entering the planet. All the things that we're talking about tonight. And I apologize for the technical side of it. I think we've got a good connection now, and let's not waste it. Let's bring back for another hour my guest from the UK, Tony Topping. Tony, welcome back.
Hello there. Can you hear me okay now?
You're perfect.
That's wonderful.
Delightful to finally be able. We were garbly, we were scratchy, we were staticky. It was all over the place. And I want to back up a little bit to where we were when we left off on the second half. Was there anything you wanted to reprise on what we were talking about?
Is there anything? Sorry, Randy, I just missed what you said.
I said, did we conclude what you were talking about?
What we were going to go into was Alec Newald, a man who was abducted in New Zealand. And what happened with him was basically it's a similar sort of thing whereby he got harassed as well. Basically, he's driving down the road in Auckland, and next minute he knows he thinks he's in a car crash, and he's floating out of his body, and he's got two ghostly figures coming towards him. He's in another environment, and he thinks, "Oh, what's going on here?" Except they weren't ghosts; they were actually aliens, and they'd actually taken him for 10 days. They'd abducted him in his book Coevolution. Coevolution, his book is called. And what is interesting is when he came back, what seemed to be
a couple of minutes being away was actually 10 days. He'd been away for 10 days and no account of it as to what had gone on. So with that, the next minute he knows, he gets a knock at the door from the from of all places, the Royal Institute of International Affairs, mm-hmm. and also, which isn't probably surprising, and also the Australian Defence Research people, wanting to confiscate his car because it had been subjected to very high voltages, and they wanted to take his car away. He refused, and he ended up being harassed and all sorts happening to him. And that was to do with the fact that he'd been in contact with a dimensional alien species, mm-hmm. whose technology had failed them, and they were having to become more like us. And this, it's all very interesting. What is interesting about this is, in terms of the fact that he's obviously, and this happened in my experiences as well, and it relates to time travel in a rudimentary way, because what's happened is, he's obviously been taken into this environment, and it's taken me 30 years of experiences to fathom out that the environment you're taken into crosses into the human afterlife, and then into another realm, which is completely their realm in another dimension, not just another planet, but another dimension.
Right.
And then you're placed back again in our time frame and in our realm. And I think in the case of what's happened here, what happens there is that you're moved across into another dimension that is forward in time from where I'm saying, it's in a very rudimentary way, from where you are at the moment. So technically speaking, you've time travel because they're further into the future than we are.
Yes.
And then
yes.
You're put back again. As a result of that, you've probably travelled along a timeline where you've passed human historical events and history, and therefore you then start getting an echo coming back at you from the future. An echo, just coming back at you, a bit like Joe McNamee in his room up you in Time Machine book, like a time echo coming back that is that's from the human kind of collective. And that's very interesting how that meshes with the concept of BST and time travel. That information I've said, but you probably wouldn't read it in any book, but the future is within the human race's presence, even though it's not happened yet. It
Absolutely.
Seems to be happening all the
yes.
time.
Yes.
You'd concur. Yeah, it seems to be happening all the time. And it's interesting, to say the least, the road that we are going down is a very hazardous one as a collective race of human beings. We could be in very deep trouble. And I do conclude, I don't know what you think, Randy, about this, America is one of the most fascist nations. Would you describe it as a fascist state? You would,
absolutely.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah, it's frightening how fascist it's become. And this overlaps as well into, obviously, World War II, what happened there with the development of technology under the Third Reich, how that
yes.
migrated into both of our countries as well, because
yes.
we have to remember that the UK and the US are linked in ways that, well, I believe a Prime Minister of Great Britain called it a special relationship. I believe that was Margaret Thatcher.
It was indeed.
And that special relationship has to do with the linkages and alliances politically, militarily, and economically as well.
Yes.
But there's the dark side of that is that there are occult connections, and those occult connections bleed over or are direct linkages as well into the things that we're talking about tonight. All of this
yes.
is on the table.
Yes, you, that's a very perceptive, one of the most perceptive comments I've heard on the whole issue of what is going on, because that's precisely what's happening. There's like a harmonic bleed over of this ancient force. They're all stood there worshipping it, doing what they're doing, their ridiculous bloody rituals, having no idea of the harmonics and the absolute interference and chaos that it's all causing. And it's very similar to the scenario in The Matrix where, Neo confronts the machine or goes to the heart of the machine and says, mm-hmm. you've got a virus in the system, you've got to sort it out. And the machine goes, why should I listen to you? Because that's what's happening. And there is a virus in the system that's currently being generated at the moment. And if we don't watch it, America will end up in a conflict whereby we're building nuclear shelters again if we're not careful. And it's I think that this country has a peculiar date with destiny with all this. Well,
You mentioned something earlier in our conversation, and you just linked into it again, the nuclear thing.
Yeah.
We know, and there's a Time magazine cover out there somewhere that actually shows this, the explosion of an atomic device creates a rip into the, what do we want to call it, probably the many levels, but this rip that occurs actually ripples out into other worlds.
It does, yes.
It has been the concern of beings who have been in contact with us that this is a major concern. They cannot allow us to continue to be nuclear. And there, it seems to be this like tenuous thing that happens where we have been withheld, but at the same time the threat still looms. And it seems like now, and I throw another log on the fire, and that's Fukushima, or as we call it, Nukushima, and what happened there. Because it seems now that the nuclear threat has gone to ground zero in terms of what's happening with nuclear plants as well. So we have real issues with this nation, which now is marauding around the globe, basically bullying and killing people on a mass scale. I mean, as an American, I'm horrified by what my country has become in my lifetime. I'm deeply concerned about what's going on within our borders, but also what has gone on in other nations. So, I mean, these are all connected, because if we go back and we study the Third Reich, Tony, you know they were occultists. You know that they were looking for the mojo to make world domination happen, and we know that Hitler at the same time was developing technology that probably is part of what we now see brought into our current military hardware.
Yes.
I know there's a whole cluster of things there.
Yeah, no. I mean, this is absolutely correct that America does have a shadow government. It is what it's looking at. We've no idea, but the occult connections to it all are certainly bleeding over into our society, and they will carry consequences. The thing is that your defense secretary, Chuck Hagel, is he called?
Mm-hmm.
Is that? I can't remember the quote verbatim, but he dropped a hint, I think, about all this, that more or less saying that I don't know whether this is correct, that the current administration seems to be aware of this, and it cannot trust any data that it's being presented with about anything at the moment, because of these agendas that are going on, making, as you say, America become a warlike marauder, bombing innocent people. You know, it is just absolutely horrendous what's going on in your country, and I have a love of the American people. I think they have a zest for life and an interest for life, and it's a shame what's happening in your country. And oddly enough, India has its own military industrial complex.
Oh yeah, I mean, which is an extension of both the British Empire and American technology as well.
They base it on the ancient Vietnamese, don't they? Their Prime Minister Indira Gandhi said that India will look at all the ancient technology that is there and put it into its military industrial complex. And so the question I ask is, if your country's intelligence community were analysing this in 1950 and reached conclusions that you're reaching and I'm reaching and another researcher, Nick Redfern, has reached, what's going on now? What's currently happening at this moment in time? You had all the remote viewing projects, didn't you? Stargate, Grill Flame, the mysterious Gondola Wish, to which nobody seems to know precisely what that project was all about, and a few others, Scanet, whatever. That's just what we're seeing in the mainstream public. But what's really the project going on there with all that? What have they really discovered? Is the interesting key to it all? And it makes you wonder if you're behind the scenes, if your nation's intelligence agencies and establishment is at war, is it civil war with each other with all this, which I think is a possibility.
Oh, very much so. Now we've talked about this before. There's clearly a schism. There's clearly a shadow government. There are clearly people within the government who are infiltrators of the shadow government who are attempting to either limit or neutralize the actions of the shadow government. That is the delicate balance of this country right now. And there are people inside the government who know that at the highest levels they have access to technology, they have access to intelligences, they have access to powers which have been conjured and brought into existence, which are the horrors that we're talking about, the mass murders, the killings, the wars, the pedophilia, and everything else that's going on, that are the really just horrendous side of human nature.
Well, this is absolutely right, and I think you'll find with the none covers it up better than the Brits when it comes to the old paedophilia stuff and all that kind of thing. You know, we're pretty good at it, as you saw with the Savile scandal.
Yeah. Let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, certainly so.
Because Savile, it's interesting how this all came out after Savile had passed on. And it picked up some momentum in the press in the UK. It bled over here a little bit, but not much. But it looked for a while like perhaps they were going to pursue this to where we would actually be able to get in a full-scale investigation. That's not happened. Is that correct, Tony?
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. In fact, the officer concerned who went on TV and said, don't sleep in your beds at night, we're coming for you, be very worried, has now been taken off the case and has got a desk job somewhere, which is bound to happen because they're not going... when you get to the real substance, what's happening at the moment is they're going for famous people. I don't know what you've noticed in the UK media, but they're actually going for famous people.
Yes.
When in fact the people that you're talking about and I'm talking about from our own research are highly dangerous men and women, very clever, not prone to mistakes, and cover their tracks well, and make other people scapegoats. And you know, you're probably talking you'd probably need to go after them with the aggression of Mossad to actually hit them, because they're laws. They don't abide by the police. The cop are knocking at the door, coming to question them. It's not going to happen. It's not the way they work. Probably controversial, but it's just not the way they work. It's not the way they roll. They're clever.
Yeah.
They're also abhorrent pieces of work. And it goes on, and it's very, very sickening. There's an MP in the UK called Tom Watson, who kind of like brought this up in our parliament regarding the fact that there was a paedophile ring going on, and he's been threatened. In fact, in Victoria, there's a place called Pimlico, and that relates to its reason why it's called Pimlico, as I understand, is because of the rent boys and the pimps that go on. And you know, as a victim of abuse myself, this absolutely horrifying what is being read about in the UK media. Horrifying how they just blatantly cover it up, as if we're all stupid over here.
I believe that some of the facts that have leaked out, that I guess we can call them facts, they're certainly at least testimony, links pedophilia and murder, basically snuffing of victims, back to even the late Prime Minister Harold Wilson.
Yeah, it certainly does. It is alleged that Ted Heath was involved with it. Is alleged, and I don't know, but it is alleged that that Margaret Thatcher was aware of it. So some researchers say.
Well, I've gone so far as to say that here in the United States, I've said this is how business gets done at the top tiers of power. We had a scandal here with Penn State University, which is very close to where I live here, which took down the head of the university, the head football coach, nationally recognized head football coach Joe Paterno, as a result of activities that went on with one of his assistant coaches. But what most people don't realize is this wasn't a blip on the map. This literally is an ongoing situation because of how deeply ingrained it is into the power structure. Most people cannot still grasp the idea that something this hideous is actually a normal part of life for the elites.
Yes, it is indeed, and you see at the end of the day, it's a very perceptive remark that you make when you said this is how business gets done, because it is. It is how business gets done with them. There's no getting away with it. That this is what's happening at the moment. And of course, you've got that ceremony, haven't you, Moloch? You know, and the which I think love him or hate him, Alex Jones did that thing, didn't
yeah,
he?
Where yeah,
he got,
that's,
he got, you know, and you've got that, and then you've got the guys who are interviewed on camera about it getting very, very jumpy when and breaking out in a sweat when questioned about what was going on there at this retreat. You know, and it's all part of what you're talking about, Randy. It's all part of the harmonic bleed over into our reality as human beings. It's all part of this crazy, insane harmonic bleed over that's happening, and we need to get a grip. Because it's not just an issue of business getting done, as far as I'm concerned. It's an issue of national security in terms of, let's say, Britain and America, where this has just got to simply stop. And, you know, I think as a person who's had abuse happen, you always have a radar for such individuals. You just develop a radar, a sixth sense for such people.
You know that, you know? Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
you certainly do. And it's what happened in the UK with Savile is just probably the tip of the iceberg. There was this issue with Newsnight as well over here. Newsnight is meant to be our flagship journalist program with the BBC, and what happened, they claimed, so it is said, that a wealthy lord called McAlpine, he never really, Newsnight never said that he'd actually done anything, but all of a sudden they had lawyers on top of them, heads rolled at the BBC over it, and it was, you know, it was pretty nasty for the Newsnight team. Even one of the key presenters, a guy called Jeremy Paxman, said that the BBC management should have stood its ground, but that didn't quite happen. Oddly enough, I've got a thing going on with the BBC at the moment where they've defamed me on camera, and they've come out with the old chest. Well, you signed a contract tough, and it's absolutely hilarious, because we have over in this country an organisation called Ofcom, which is the equivalent of the FCC, and what Ofcom do is they do something called a preliminary view, which is a view of the complaint I have made and a view of what the broadcaster is saying in response to that complaint. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And their response, as I've told them, so is just totally biased towards the broadcaster, and the thing is that you've got in this report that Ofcom have done, it's as if I've shot John F. Kennedy, the way they're carrying on. You know, we were looking at conspiracies regarding 7/7, and like you said at the beginning, the Boston thing, there's some sinister modus operandis that keep cropping up. Much as I'd like to say that it's an incident, plain and simple, there's these odd modus operandis that keep cropping up in any of these incidents that I find disturbing.
Well, just start with the dates. You always see the patterns. And
yes.
You know, I haven't written about Boston just because after Sandy Hook here last year, it was excruciating doing the research and writing about it. I mean, it takes, you know, endless hours to write, but writing is really just the mechanics of the thinking process. But in terms of Boston and what's going on there, again, you're looking at occult dates. You have particular patterns that pop up. You have little mysterious hooks that kind of come into play with it. They're signatures, and I call them spiritual signatures, because there's an element of the demonic that falls into all of this, that once you begin to train yourself to understand it, you start seeing it all over the place, in large events and small. Have you kind of notice these patterns as well, Tony?
Yes, that's precisely what's going on. That is precisely what's happening. And the thing is that you've got to have a trained eye to notice it, and it comes from years of experience. It's not the realization of this is not given to you on a plate overnight. It comes from years of experience and observation of watching the goon squad in question. You know what you're talking about, and I know what I'm talking about. And it's time that it is time the United States got a grip of its security regarding all this, because I do think it's a national security threat to my nation and your nation. And yes, you can't help therefore but think that there are occult connotations as to what happened. Who was the guy on the roof, by the way? The media in the UK don't seem to have done anything to do with this guy on the roof when the bomb went off. There was a guy on a roof. I don't know. Did you notice that? Have you seen it? I've heard this.
In
the Daily Telegraph here in the UK.
But see, it's not playing here in the United States. What's playing here in the United States, you get a different... It's really interesting. We now live in the age of the internet, so we do have a bit more free flow of information if we look at the way foreign coverage is handled. In this case, that particular item gets no play. What gets play is the FBI identifying the two, I guess, Russian, nominally Chechen brothers, whom they've identified as the culprits, and now the ramp up to justice, because they've already been judged, so it really doesn't matter. One of them's dead, the other one's in the hospital, and basically the laws in the U.S., the anti-terrorist laws, basically state that these guys will never see a trial. Anyway, so no, that news doesn't play here. There were anomalies on the ground from the minute this thing hit. I very rarely watch TV, and I almost never watch news. Randomly, because I was home that day, I turn my TV on, and I see this live coverage, and I start watching it. The number of federal agents that they had on the ground, and the number of agencies that were there, and the earliest reports from Boston tell me everything was prepositioned. That this was basically all set up. And it's like I said in my monologue at the beginning of the show, these people were not here to protect us. They were there to pull another op, just like they did at Sandy Hook, just like they did in Aurora, Colorado, and everywhere else that we've had some type of violent assault on civilians.
Yes, and what is baffling about this, Randy, in terms of your country, what is baffling about this is you have 35 intelligence agencies or thereabouts, all with different names. None of them, you have drones, you have surveillance, you have the National Security Agency, one of the high-tech agencies, and it's and then you have all these laws, TSA everywhere, yet still an event like that happens. And will continue to happen. And all the agencies look round baffled because, as you rightly said, there is a hidden component element to it. And it will continue unless they get a grip of it. It certainly will. But you see, there was a commentator on your in the UK media who's from the US. He was on Five Live, more or less saying that after what's happened at Boston, it is fair to say that we need now to have our freedoms slightly taken away from us in for our protection. What the hell's that all about?
Well, there isn't a hell of a lot of freedom left to take.
Exactly.
What they're going to do is they've militarized our police here.
Right.
They have turned our airports into security zones so strict that the air travel is now just completely excruciating. We're seeing it on the local level as well with, the way the police are responding to civilians. There's a sense of oppression in this country right now that is quite palpable and quite remarkable. I don't remember anything like it in my lifetime. So the country itself is going into lockdown. And you mentioned the drones. Well, I think this was probably a pretext for positioning the drones because there's been a lot of pushback. But Boston certainly makes the case that now we need surveillance. We need intervention from the air. Your guy on the roof, well, the drone could have taken them out. And so every time that one of these ops, we lose a little bit more. They didn't get the gun control they wanted after the Sandy Hook incident. So now there needed to be another incident, another way to create the pretext for more control.
It does seem to be the case, Randy, but do you think that this is a rogue element within the U.S. administration that is causing this, or do you think that Obama literally sits down with his team?
This is the power structure. This is the power structure now, but Obama is part of the rogue, and I can say this categorically, because I know people who knew Obama when he was Barry Satoru, and if you've listened to, we have, I've interviewed a witness named Andrew Basiago, who was part of a project in the United States in the 1970s called Pegasus, which had to do with basically jump rooms, and eventually it had to do with jump rooms to Mars under the aegis of the U.S. military. Andrew Basiago and one of the other people who has come out as being part of this project said that Barry Satoru was in this project. Barry Satoru was basically a guy who was completely for himself, completely controlled by his handlers, and that because of what they were using in terms of technology, a piece of equipment called a chronovisor, they actually knew who the next U.S. presidents would be, going back to at least George Bush forward. So they knew that the two Bushes, Clinton, Sotero, a.k.a. Obama, were going to be president. All of this was prepositioned. I understand really that you, if you have not heard these stories, that requires a bit of suspension of belief, but I've done a lot of research on this. Andrew Basiago is an attorney, and he's rather well-known and rather well-respected. So we take these stories, and the U.S. presidents that we've had are prepositioned. They are part of what would have been considered the black government, which is now like a cancer, almost completely taken over the United States.
The worry is, Randy, from
your
point...
I feel like you're interviewing me. This is fun.
I am. Yes, I am, actually. Yes, I am. Sorry. The worry, because the worry is, obviously, the worry is with your country that's meant to be land of the free, and with my country. The worry is this, is that when these incidents start to happen, I noticed, very much so, the media in which it was leaning towards the fact that perhaps somebody like you, Randy, or somebody like me are a terrorist, and we've got to watch, you know... We're the people to watch. So that one minute it was Al-Qaeda, the next minute it's the Muslims, and then it suddenly escalates and ramps up to the ordinary man in the street. And it's something that we have to furiously guard against in this country as well, where we have to defend our free speech. And that seems to be what's happening. I noticed that in the media, that the American media, anyway, were gearing up for this assault on people who had an alternative point of view or a critical thinking of the worldview around them are suddenly then labeled extremists or terrorists, and it's wrong.
By doing what we're doing on this show and the shows that you appear on, we are at least putting ourselves out there. I have to assume that because of the way communications are monitored universally, that I show up on somebody's map somewhere, some red list. You know, honestly, at the end of the day, if that concerns you, then you probably shouldn't do this kind of thing. I take the position that I'm looking for the truth, and I'm not going to give up until I find it, and there's a cost to that.
It's actually an observation of what your media was doing during the incident. Apart from one guy on CNN who said that we can't really go down this road. It seems to be a dangerous... in other words, as you have rightly said, you're getting your freedom erased bit by bit by bit. Very subtle. But what is the end game? I'm just not sure what the end game is with it all. You know, it's absolutely just unbelievable as to where they could be leading to with all this, and that's the bit that I'm not sure of. I really am not.
Well, I know that the observations that I hear from my friends in Europe are that they are appalled looking at the United States and seeing what the American people have tolerated so far. Even if you took all the events of 9/11 as the way they were presented as true, even if you took any of these incidences as they were presented as true, it is not a pretext for taking away rights which were not given to us by our government in the first place. Our founding documents said we hold these truths to be self-evident.
This is the issue.
These rights came to us as a part of God, natural law, whatever you want to call it.
That
we're inherently
issue.
Free beings.
Yes, that is the absolute issue. That really is, and I think the other thing as well, Randy, over here in the UK, we have the Magna Carta, and you know, we're having at the moment freemen on the land and all that kind of thing. But when you look at the UK government, for example, if you look at it as the actions of a corporation rather than a government, you then it all suddenly fits into place as to what they're doing. They're acting as a corporation for the private banks. And it fits into place very nicely as to what they're doing, and you tend to then perceive it all very differently. But as you say all the time, when these incidents happen, there's always the subtle erosion of freedom, the subtle yanking up of the control over people for some bizarre reason. And Alex Jones, much as I have reservations about him, he appeared on the Piers Morgan show and made an idiot of himself because his most crucial issue was this, and he didn't talk about it either, was, okay, gun control, yeah, fine. But they weren't just doing gun control, were they, Randy? They were actually altering the Second Amendment with unconnected things that I'd really had no... I may have got this wrong. This is what I was picking up in the UK anyway. They were altering the Second Amendment, so it had a broader remit, a broader level of erosion, as it were.
Right. Well, the right to bear arms has always been contested on certain wording within the amendment itself, which had to do with militias, a word that they do not like in this country, but in fact, whether they like it or not, there are militias here, and they may in fact be the gray line between all of us. One of the listeners in the chat room pointed something out here, and it was, they basically asked me to ask you if you're aware of the Georgia Guidestones.
Yes, actually, we went a bit off-piste, didn't we? We've gone into the realm of... Yes, I am aware
of it. That's okay.
That's all right. Yeah, is that all right? Yeah, well, the Georgia Guidestones, yes, I am aware of it, and I find it a very sinister piece of... what's the word we're looking for? Statue, isn't it? I just find it very sinister. Guy walks into the stonemasons, doesn't he? He says, can you do this for us? And they come out with it, and they've got these little commandments on it. Very sinister, frankly. And all part of the harmonic bleed over what we're talking about. All connected, all interconnected to it, isn't it?
Well, it has to do with eugenics, and it has to do with the elimination of massive numbers of people to turn, to rewild the earth, basically.
Yes.
Your country intellectually kind of developed that idea to a high degree. The intellectuals in your country developed eugenics, and we have exported this now as an idea. There's a lot of deception about things like global warming, overpopulation. They're misreporting numbers. They're skewing data to make it appear as though humans are simply fleas on the back of Mother Earth. And that's not to take anything away from the planet. But to go back to your original question, the reason why you're concerned about the United States is because traditionally, we were viewed as a bulwark of freedom, and now we're the opposite of that. This opens the door to what could become global genocide. It will affect every nation on this planet.
Yes, yes.
This is the linchpin.
Yes, it is. It is. I think, in other words, your country does hold the linchpin to all this. It certainly does. It has a peculiar date with destiny. It certainly does. And I just don't know where it's going to go in the long term. We're getting echoes of on a timeline. In my position, I hear things all the time about what could possibly be or not be, and it's just simply not good. It really, really isn't good. And it's
talk to me about that a little bit. Echoes on the timeline. And you know what? As long, like I said, we'll go as long as it's interesting. And to me, we're having a great conversation, so I'm not looking at the clock. But let's talk about this, the echoes and the timelines a little bit, Tony.
Yeah. Well, what you've got going on there, for example, is the bizarre. It's not bizarre. That's the wrong word. Well, I'm saying it's bizarre because I find it bizarre. But perhaps in my framework of experiences, it probably isn't that bizarre. But what you've got going on there is you've got kind of like a possibility that there is a person in the supermarket, for example, walk down the supermarket. And I won't just, you'll hear an individual, but there's a possibility that that individual who you're hearing in the ether, you're not just hearing them in the present, you're hearing them in the future as to what they could be and where they're going. It's a very interesting concept of what's happening. And you kind of like, you hear this, when you've been displaced into another dimension and then put back again, you're hearing time coming back at you as to what events might happen or what events may not happen. And it's peculiar in terms of America because there is this. These ETs are definitely concerned over the nuclear issue, and they're definitely concerned over the activities of China, which has concealed itself very well as to what it's actually up to. And it seems to me that there's a possibility you're going to have a woman president as well. That seems to be on the cards from all I'm picking up. But the nuclear issue is definitely present with them, and they keep referring to this constantly, to the point where it's now scaring me. I've had over the past 3 weeks it all being ramped up, the stuff to do with the ET stuff. They've kept very quiet over the years. They've stepped back. They've not said much. They've let me be battered from pillar to post. But over the last 3 weeks, they've just stepped in. and they've stated what was going on, and that's kind of like, it's just very bizarre, because you're in an environment that is not the human dream world. When we go to sleep, we dream, and we have these dreams, and we may have nightmares and stuff like that. But I actually believe that in some cases, some of us are involved in their dream world, in their environment, in their inception, which is separate to the human race, and it can bleed over. And you know, when you're in that environment, you just know about it. You know about it if one of these aliens comes up. I mean, they look like us. Some of them actually look like us, except they're kind of like, their nasal structure and forehead structure is slightly mm-hmm, different, mm-hmm. And their understanding. I mean, for example, you know, I was deeply relaxed the other day into many levels. I was fast asleep, and I was just sent deeper and deeper into this relaxation level, and I came face to face with somebody who was definitely an ET, who explained, you know, that there was a nuclear issue going on, and that the fact that the natives were playing with toys was one of the things that they've come out with, whereby they're observing that we're larking about with technology that really is lethal, and one of the key things that they come out with is that the nuclear bomb shouldn't really have been invented, in our hands anyway, you know. So over these past 3 weeks, I've been exposed to all kinds of strange goings on, where they've just ramped up what they are and who they are, or one of them has, one of these groups has. You know, they're very ancient, they've been around a long time, mm-hmm. And their population level is only very small. In some cases, you're talking about a planet with about 2,000, 3,000 of them on, in some cases. And it can get a bit too much, and you wonder who is friend and who is foe with all this.
Are we agreed that there are both benevolent and malevolent forces out there that are involved in all of this?
Yeah, I think we are. That is the total conclusion I have made. I know Dr. Stephen Greer, who is a man I actually admire because of working the disclosure thing. He had a very interesting run-in with those two at Project Camelot, who don't touch me with a barge pole. I don't think you're a fan of them. Oh, it's true, is it right? Sorry, yeah, I heard the report. Yeah, but basically, in a nutshell, Dr. Greer said that there's no hostile aliens at all. That doesn't happen, and unfortunately, it does.
Well,
happen.
In all fairness, in that particular dialogue, this was the two extremes of the poles. I did not agree with his summary. On the other hand, Project Camelot has been exploiting hostile alien thesis fear porn for as long as they've been around, and Kerry has continued to do that. So you had two polar opposites, when in fact I believe, based on everything that I know, everything that I've heard, the people I've spoken to, is that there is somewhat of a balance here, because there are benevolence and there are evil, and we have to understand this game from that particular perspective, and then begin to discern who's who.
Yeah, this is absolutely correct, and it would appear that some of us as human beings are actually involved in this game for reasons that we don't understand. We're not given any information as to why, and we go on to the dangerous obsession path as well. I mean, I became obsessed with filming UFOs, and I've filmed quite a few of them. And I became absolutely obsessed with going out and filming them, and to no avail. There was nothing productive coming from it. It was just an absolute waste of time. And so, not only is this polarity there of good and evil with them, there's also this cost, this price on one's life, where you can't seem to live a normal life because of it all. You're walking around in a shattered state all the time, and you know, you're on your own. There's nobody else that's willing to actually help you. It can get all very heavy going, and I just feel that at the moment, there's still this total sense of lack of direction. I mean, you know, I can only this morning, and I can't even remember what it was about, that it was happening again this morning where I'm asleep, but yet something else is going on. And you wake up from it, Randy, absolutely shattered. You don't know where you are with it.
Yeah.
And it's because it's not you they're interested in. I don't think it's me that's sat here now speaking that they're possibly interested in. I think it's something else that they're interested in. And that takes a lot of working out as well. So you've got all this kind of, you're trying to suss out this massive landscape of data that's coming at you that is not human, that the government says doesn't exist. You're accused of being a nutter, and that the gauntlet is run. And then you've got strange people following you, which is, and these are kind of like, it's just insane, and no man should be really subjected to this like I've been. I mean, the psychotronic weapons that they were using, I mean, in January 2001, round about 3 a.m, you know, I was hit hard. I thought I wouldn't wake up the next day. I thought I'd probably die, right, because I was hit hard with this bizarre Hitchcock-style stabbing into the center of the forehead. And what's even more sinister, yep. what's even more sinister about it is the ability for them to keep you asleep, and the ability for your awareness to bizarrely enjoy what's going on, because they've got so much control of your brain. So they've got the pleasure centers activated while they're whacking you good and hard with this Hitchcock style stabbing. But, and I strongly believe that part of this experimentation that went on was to do with development of a weapons platform. I think whoever they were developing, and I think that the UFO stuff was an incidental sideline, and the possibility they were developing some bizarre weapons platform that's out there at the moment, and that's a serious.
Now, when you say they, Tony, can you narrow that down a little bit to just who you suspect?
There's some form of classified agency out there that is involved in the matters that you've stated. That's definitely going off piste, is completely off its loco, and is doing stuff that it shouldn't be doing. And they all spoke English, apart from one woman who spoke with a slight foreign accent. But I think you're looking at a cabal of individuals who have been tracking me very, very closely. But I think, Randy, that they got out of their depth with me. Because when you've got these UFOs coming over, they don't mess about. Their technology is very advanced. And I think that the people who targeted me became out of their depth with me and backed away. Because they suddenly realised that I was somebody else's commodity, somebody else's breeding stock, somebody else's whatever I am, that didn't belong to them. And I think that hint has been given. And I do think that whoever these people are fully aware of the UFO situation and have been for centuries. I don't think it's a new thing with them. It's just that it's all kept quiet. And I think that the ETs are involved in the silence as well of it. So when we go on about disclosure, we have to put into the equation that there's a possibility that there are elements of extraterrestrials that may be involved in the UFO cover-up as well. Don't want human beings to know that they actually exist, for whatever reason that may be.
That was a pretty comprehensive statement, actually, Tony. It lines up with, you know, pretty much what I believe as well. You know, we do have to hold that there's a complicity. There's no reason to believe that our government has the ability on their own to suppress the knowledge of extraterrestrial beings if those beings themselves wish to make themselves known on a grand scale.
Yeah, this is absolutely. I mean, I know, for example, there was somebody who came up to me at a UFO conference who said that she was involved with, had been involved with the British Civil Service at some point, and she was retired. She was a charming woman. She said, "I don't want to talk about what I know because I'm happily retired." She says, "And if I do talk about what I know, I'll start getting the heat like you're having heat," she said. "But I will tell you this," she said, the government department I worked in became very, very concerned about cattle mutilations, mm-hmm. and what was going on with them, and we were very concerned about that, and with that she bid me farewell and wandered off. And so, you know, there's that incident as well of the unmarked helicopters and cattle mutilations that are currently going on at the moment. And that's the other thing that you've got. You're painting a whole landscape here, aren't you, of issues and problems to which the human race appear to be in the middle of, but yet strangely don't acknowledge. And it's distinctly sinister. I'm not sure who is responsible for the cattle mutilations, but it does seem to cause great concern within the framework of government in general.
Yeah, that's really an X factor in all of this, because it was so prevalent here in the U.S. for so long. It's really not talked about a whole lot now. It was a hot topic for a while in ufology, but it hasn't been revisited. It's almost become like a sort of silenced subject.
Yes, indeed. And then there's the other thing as well to do with this harmonic bleed over and these sinister forces that are out there. Because I know of a man who works in NASA. I don't know him personally, but I know of a man who is a NASA scientist, and he's very well known. And he was working on propulsion calculations on behalf of I don't know what it was on behalf of, but he was actually working on propulsion calculations, and he started having extraterrestrial contact experiences. He awoke in his room to discover two ET stood there showing him a star map. And he couldn't quite believe it. And he's a prominent NASA scientist. And with that, and then what happened then is that he started going. He was driving down the road with his girlfriend, and the UFO was parked to the left. Do you know who this guy is? Without saying too much, do you have an idea?
I do not.
You do not. Right. Okay. So what happened was he was working on these propulsion calculations. He was stuck on them, and he was helped by his encounters to revise the calculations. The book is published. He has a major website, but nothing at all about his.
If you can send me those links at some point, I'd like to see that. It can be something that's just not on my radar.
It won't be on your radar at the moment. But the thing is, because of these four. Is what we're talking about, Randy, what you've so rightly talked about. He can't speak. He can't actually speak because, as he has rightly said, there are forces there that are keeping this all with the lid firmly on, and they're ancient esoteric forces. And, you know, he had to change it. He was interviewed by Whitley Strieber, and he had to change his voice. And oddly enough, it was a relative who sent me an email for some bizarre reason saying, yeah, he's my sister's boyfriend, he said in this email, and he's so-and-so, Mr. So-and-so.
Wow.
And sure enough, he was. I don't think it's safe for it to be widely known who he is. But yeah, definitely so. And it's on my YouTube channel, TONYOPSUFO, the actual interview with him and what he went through. But he's quite happy to be part of the scientific establishment. He made no bones about it. He was quite happy to be part of that. And these are these interesting developments that kind of like crop up when you realise that on my Facebook page, for example, I've got people following me from various aerospace companies. Aerospace and defence companies.
Yes, I'm sure you do.
Yeah, well, yes. Well, you say I'm sure you do, but when I first saw that, I go, oh, what was that about? Oh, well, that would make sense.
Well, when you start pulling IP addresses off your website and you see the intelligence agencies and defence contractors who are looking at your website.
China Lake. particularly China Lake Naval Facility. Seems to have been, in the old days, it seemed to hit quite a lot, did that. And it was interesting to note that there's a possibility that some of these guys have also had UFO encounters and are keeping it quiet as well. It's as if in some cases the genuine contact, bypassing all this crap and bleed over, these genuine contact encounters are actually ongoing, and they're very selective as to who they're speaking to, I would suggest. Certainly food for thought.
The silence behind this in the general public is what we're battling. We're battling the science. This is the great taboo, talking about this subject. You know, many, many years ago, it would have been in the Victorian era something sexual. There's always been societal taboos. This is the societal taboo now, to talk about this. And why it's important, and why people who come on shows like this, people like you, bring their testimony forward, is because each time we put that data out there, we put it into the information stream, and we encourage other people who have similar experiences to come forward and talk about it. And that's what needs to happen. We have to get a critical mass of people who are willing to identify as experiencers and who are willing to share their experiences and stop the silence, because that's what they fear.
Yeah, well, you are quite correct. I mean, I've no idea what would happen if this man declared his hand, you know, in public.
Well, I guarantee you his life is at stake. Before he ever spoke, he would be, you know, he'd have an accident.
Yeah, yeah, indeed. And this is the gauntlet that you're running, and I think it's heading for disaster. And I really,
Not only that, Tony. The difficulty that we've had in this conversation tonight is with concepts that kind of escape verbal description anymore, because we're talking about events, we're talking about phenomena that really isn't part of the common language. So how do you describe it? How do you describe multidimensional?
Absolutely.
How do you describe bleed-throughs? And yes, we're going through this whole period of time here where the energetics in the earth are changing, where things are shifting, and there's a window of opportunity to begin to somehow communicate this. I think that's why the internet was created, frankly.
Yeah, well, indeed, isn't it? Because it always fascinates me regarding the Wingmakers, where the Wingmakers website, where they comment on the internet being a kind of gateway, something a bit bigger. I just find the concept of that absolutely fascinating.
Well, and it was 1998 when they went live with the first website, and of course, it's changed over the years a lot. But that was bleeding edge at the time.
Yes, it was. It certainly was. It certainly was bleeding edge at the time. There's something more to it than meets the eye. For me here in the UK, it's just coming up to 4:10. I'm tired out now. My energy's going.
Absolutely.
But it's been, you know, it's been an absolute blast. I don't know whether anybody in the chat room would like to ask any questions with your permission, Randy. I don't know whether you do that. Do you want to hear?
No. I put field out for questions constantly. Yep. There was one question, and it was... do you know Nigel Kerner?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I know his work, familiar with his work, yes.
Yes, we've done extensive interviews with Nigel and his associates here, and they just wanted to know what you thought about Nigel's work, which is basically grey aliens and the harvesting of souls.
Yes, indeed. I never, ever have come across a grey in all my experiences. I've come across Nordics, redheads, all that kind of thing, but never, ever have I seen a grey. In 30 years of doing this.
Interesting.
Which is incredible, isn't it? But no, but his first book was super. I've not read his second, but I enjoyed his first book very much.
Yes.
Really did. And he's a bit of a lone wolf as well, because the mainstream UFO community in Britain don't really deal with him either. In fact, you know, they don't. And it's a shame, really, because I think he's got a lot to say.
Yeah. I'm just kind of scanning the chat room to see if there's anything else. Any other questions you guys want to get? Sometimes we do call-ins, but lately we've been getting a lot of phone activity, and we had a troublesome Skype line tonight. Listen, Tony, I know it's 4 in the morning for you. It's getting late here. I really appreciate you staying up early and talking to us over here. Did you get your website situation straightened out?
Yeah, I'm going to get that sorted out by the weekend. It's to do seemingly with demands of money from various...
Of course it is.
The usual. So, but no, I'll have that sorted by the weekend.
Okay, give out your websites, your YouTube, your Facebook, any way that people can get in touch
and on
with
Facebook,
you.
Facebook, you can find me on TONYOPSUFO. You can also find me on my YouTube channel, which is also called TONYOPSUFO. My main website is TonyTopping.com. Currently down at the moment, that will come back up as TonyTopping.net, and I do have my own radio show on Blog Talk that deals with current affairs, UFOs, the paranormal. That's called the Tony Topping Show. I'm also a media contributor within the UK. I'm on quite a bit of media, from BBC to ITV. I'm on TV and radio a lot, really, talking about all this, which is a good thing. And the mainstream media so far have actually treated me very well here in the UK on this subject. I've had a good crack of the whip with them, actually.
Yeah,
it's Mr. Jones and his merry mob at InfoWars who censored me rather bizarrely. But there you go. You know, you live and learn.
They don't want to deal
yep.
with this subject. That's a no, stretch they can't take. Tony, all this information goes out on the websites over the weekend. Sorry, folks, I can't get up faster than that. OffPlanetRadio.com, OffPlanetRadio.net. You can find the interview there to listen to it again. All the links will be with it. I want to say thanks to you, Tony. Stay on the line for a minute. I'll close the show out.
Will do. Yep, will do.
Next week, coming up, we will have with us Chris Carter, and he's somewhere in the Pacific Rim, I believe, in Taiwan. We'll be talking to him. Science and the Afterlife Experience, Evidence for the Immortality of Consciousness. Again, digging deep into the spiritual side of life. We'll be back again with another show next week. I'm Randy Maugans. This is Off Planet Radio. The truth is out there. It's inside you. Keep looking for it.